démarré. Ça veut dire que c'est bien parti. Et comme d'habitude, aux environs de H-1 minute, les portes latérales seront ouvertes et vous pourrez assister au lancement. Merci de votre attention.
Mesdames et messieurs, bonsoir, en direct du Centre spatial guyanais, ici à Kourou, en Guyane française, Amérique du Sud. Voici le vol 139 d'Ariane Espace. Je m'appelle Brett Klein, je fais le commentaire pour vous en langue française. Avec moi en cabine, Jacques Boucher.
Bonsoir Brett, bonsoir à tous, heureux de vous retrouver ce soir pour des commentaires techniques.
For our English audience, greetings to you wherever you may be, and welcome to Kourou, the home of Ariane, for tonight's live broadcast of Ariane Space Flight Number 139. I'm Joshua Jample for the commentary. With me in the booth is my friend Pierre Michele Roviera.
Hi, Josh. Good evening, everybody.
This is a summary of the events of tonight's launching. First, the preparation of the launcher itself, an Ariane 44L, putting into geostationary transfer orbit two military telecommunications satellites, the Italian Sicral and the British Skynet 4F. We will have a quick look at the final preparations of the satellites in the clean room here at the Guyanese Space Center. Then, of course, comes the launching and the step-by-step process of putting the satellites into orbit.
So, why... I wait for Josh to climb in the booth. Just a few words in my mother language. Un saluto a tutti gli italiani in ascolto e una buona serata e un buon lancio. Ci sentiamo dopo. This is the green panel. Here in Jupiter we check the systems, not only the launcher of the spacecraft, but all the systems we need for this mission. And as you can see, it is not all green. We have a red on the Skynet spacecraft. So normally we'll have a little delay. We are still waiting for more information. We will keep informed as soon as we have it. Hi, Josh.
Greetings. Greetings, everybody. We're back. It took us 50 seconds to climb back. 50 seconds to climb back into the skybox.
The launch window for tonight's event is 1 hour, from 1900 hours 28 to 2028 local Kourou time. The launch will be broadcast in Washington and in Sunnyvale, California. The launch is also being broadcast in Stevenage and Portsmouth in Great Britain, in Rome, Italy, and of course at Ariane Espace headquarters in Évry outside Paris. Tonight's launcher is the heaviest and most powerful of the Ariane 4 family, the 44L. It stands 56.3 meters tall, with the fairing, and includes four strap-on liquid boosters. The 44L weighs in at 486 tons at liftoff.
Right, we're still waiting for the red on the satellite to go green again. Pierre Michele, you're not happy with that figure, the 486 tons that we just saw.
No, in fact, it is a little mistake. The real mass is 478 at ignition, which is 74 at liftoff, since we burn 4 tons in the ignition sequence.
The ignition sequence lasting roughly four seconds. We'll get back to that when we come down to ignition time, because there's a whole series of events and checks before the launcher takes off that we want to describe to you. For the moment, we're going to go to the launch summary to give you a better idea of what's coming up.
Tonight's Ariane 44L launching is placing two military telecommunications satellites into GTO for the Italian Defense Ministry and for the British Defense Ministry. Sicral is the first Italian military satellite constructed by the CTAB consortium for the Defense Ministry. The consortium is headed by Elenia Spazio, the satellite builder, then Fiat Avio for the propulsion and launching systems, and Telespazio for all ground installations. Over to Great Britain now. Skynet 4F was built by Astrium in Stevenage for the UK Defense Ministry. It will control all tactical and strategic telecommunication services in the UK. It is part of a family of three satellites, with the 4D and 4E. Ariane Espace has already launched 3 Skynet satellites in 1988, 1990, and 1999. The Italian Sicral will be placed over Congo and the British Skynet 4F over the Gulf of Guinea, both in Africa.
Just under 14 minutes, we're still holding. This part of the status panels is green, as you can see. There's the red on the satellite. As soon as we have anything to pass along to you about status of the satellite, we will, of course, do so. In the meantime, take a look at Rémy Cochet, one of 6 Ariane Space mission directors. Coordinates the campaign among Ariane Space, the customer, and the space base, working in tandem with Pierre Barbier, the dean of the DDOs, what we call the Range Operations Manager, who coordinates all the information coming in from the different sites across this very large, very vast launch base. One of those sites where we happen to have a camera tonight is at a place called the CDL, the Launch Center. They are about 13, 14 kilometers roughly toward the northwest from where we are here in Jupiter, the CDL. You see the Launch Operations Manager. They're up there about a kilometer from the launch pad, is that right?
We are about 15 kilometers from here.
And they are...
And just 1 kilometer from the launch vehicle.
And his people, the CO, the COEL's people, there are 100 or 200 of them, checking out only the launch operations.
Only the launcher operations, yeah. The COEL is the real pilot of the launcher in the cockpit, the CDL.
The Jupiter building?
The Jupiter building is the control tower.
The launch campaign 139 began here with the arrival of the first stage container at the Cool Harbor. After transportation on the pad number 2, we have integrated the third stage on the launch table. This is the first day of the campaign. The second day, we integrate the second stage, which is hoisted here and it docked with the first stage. After these 2 days, we begin with the integration of the 4 liquid strap-on boosters. They are docked here with special cranes on the central core. Finally, the third stage is hoisted on the same way and integrated on the launcher. This is completed by the vehicle equipment bay that you see here, which is actually a plate containing all the navigation systems of the launcher. After this operation and electrical and fluid checkout of the launcher, we have here the rollout to the launch pad. The launcher arrives on the umbilical tower and we close the cryogenic filling device, which is used during the countdown to fill the third stage with propellant. This phase is completed when the gantry is moved back on the launcher. At D-5, the satellite arrives. They are encapsulated. You see here Sucra and Skynet. They are hoisted atop of the launcher at D-4, and only at D-4 the launcher is completely integrated.
The voice of Rémy Cochet, the mission director, giving you a rundown on the launcher campaign. There's one for every launcher, and normally taking about 25 to 26 working days. The men from satellites.
We have Michael Callery, which is the program director for Sicral, from the Ariane Space Directorate, commercial directorate.
Now his job, being a commercial person, is to be what?
He has the management of the contract, the launch contract, after he signed. Mauro Attili, which is a Sicral manager.
Have we any news on the satellite?
Well, the controls, further controls and operations are running in these very minutes. We will keep you informed as soon as we have some more information about this little delay.
So they're doing the normal checks?
They do normal and further checks, checking again all the systems on board and on the ground as well.
Well, as soon as we have something, we will, of course, pass it along. The launch base here in Ariane Space taking every precaution, 1,001 things to check out before the vehicle will be authorized to leave the pad, of course. The security of the people in the base, the first thing, the people in the local population, of course, the ground installations here, primary importance. So everybody making sure everything is ship shape before we take off.
And we just saw Alex Madembassy, who is the mission manager, Ariane Space for Sicral, for Skynet, who was very busy at the moment since he's working very hard.
Just while we're looking, a thumbnail, you can still see the red there, we're still waiting, 8 minutes to go. A thumbnail sketch of the launcher, if you just, if you're joining us for the first time for the mission. Three-stage, three-powered vehicle. There's Ariane's chairman, Jean-Marie Luton.
And in the meantime, we just have the final weather forecast for the launch window, and we are green over all the windows.
We're green to go. The last, the final weather check comes at minus 10 minutes.
Minus 10 minutes, yeah.
Take a look now at the latest news from the Ariane Space Company. That's coming up. Last year was a vintage year for Ariane Space. We tied our record for launches with 12, but also the Ariane 5 came into her own with 4 successful flights. So Chairman Luton had lots to talk about at the first of the year press conference. Among the announcements, 4 more contracts signed, 3 old friends from 3 different nations. DirecTV 4S, built by Boeing in the U.S., will be launched at the end of this year or early next. That's the third in the fleet launched by Ariane. Inset 3A and 3E will also go up later this year and next year. These telecom and weather sats are built by the Indian Space Research Organization, the 9th and 10th contracts with Ariane. Finally, Israel's second communications satellite, Amos 2, will bring digital TV to the Mideast and be a backup for Amos 1, launched by Ariane in 1996. Ariane Space's industrial partners got together early this month in Paris for Industrial Days. On the program, development, production, and further evolution of the Ariane family. On January 10th of this year, Ariane Space unveiled its new logo. This is an integral part of the revamping of the graphic image of Ariane Space. As you can see here, this new logo has basically evolved from the one we've used for the first 20 years of the company's life. It was easily recognizable. The change today is soft but quickly noticeable. The evolution of the logo, in fact, represents the transition from the Ariane 4 to the Ariane 5 launcher, which we're currently bringing on the market. This transition is based on our SADA launch experience over the past years, and the new launcher fits very well with the current telecommunications environment. We're using our vast experience to benefit our clients. Right, we're coming down to the 6 minute mark, which is the beginning normally of the synchronized sequence, what we call the automatic sequence. Now, what happens if we get to the 6 minutes? We can't go past that if we have a red.
No, normally if we still red, we will stop the count at -6 exactly, since the last 6 minutes are a computer program you cannot interrupt, and if you have any problem during this phase, you automatically go back to the -6 minutes, which is a very important phase, and you have to run it fully.
And you can see we've just stopped at -6 minutes. And at the beginning of the synchronized sequence, we have not got the authorization to move into the automatic sequence where the computers take over. As soon as we do, we'll give you, of course, an explanation of that, because it's a very interesting procedure, the final moments of this final countdown.
Thank you. tous et les deux. Donc les deux projets ont demandé la prolongation de l'arrêt pour une reconfiguration de leur réseau de stations. Tous les moyens doivent se tenir prêts à partir de 23h TU. Je répète, tous les moyens se doivent d'être prêts pour une reprise du décompte à partir de 23h TU.
Well, you can see we're still waiting in this run up until 8 o'clock, another quarter of an hour. We're going to offer you this unexpected look at some of the scenes and situations related to the launch base. We're going to have another film coming up for you shortly. The pictures of the boats are interesting because parts of the Ariane 4 all come from Europe. They're not manufactured here, so they're shipped across the Atlantic. And there are now two rather large ships of 1 million and some pounds, I think, if I'm not mistaken, which bring the stages over for the Ariane 4. For the Ariane 5, it's a little different. Most of the parts come from Europe, except for the solid boosters, which are made here, right?
Yeah, you're right. The solid boosters are made here in what we call the UPG, which is the Guyana Proper Gold Factory. And
it's the first time in the program that any part of the launch vehicle was actually manufactured here on the site, because before everything came over from Europe.
It is the first time. Well, really, they were too big to be transported.
All right, have a look now at some other shots, and we'll be back around 11.
Retour au vert du satellite Skynet 4F, des retours au vert de Sicral, nous engagerons la procédure de redémarrage. À tous de l'EDO, tous les moyens se tiennent prêts pour une reprise du décompte sur très court préavis.
All right. I think we're going to be ready to go. You see the Skynet has gone back to green. The Sicral, the Italian satellite, went red, which was normal, they tell us, because everything was being reconfigured up there.
Yes. In fact, when there is a long delay like this evening, you have to reconfigure the spacecraft according to the ground tracking station for the new exact time of ignition and liftoff.
Because obviously we've changed our...
This takes some time, so the red is just normal because they are reconfigurating the new launch time.
So the ground stations asked to have a little more time to set their...
To set the new parameter, and we should turn green in a few moments.
We should be going. Now we have a launch window originally of what was it, an hour?
Yeah, you're right. Now we have just 28 minutes, less than half an hour.
To launch, but of course we only need 6, so we should be all right.
Yeah.
So we're waiting for the DDO, whom you will hear, to announce the synchronized sequence commencement and the return to green from the Italian satellite. Meanwhile, as you can see, Ariane 4 waiting patiently, like we all are, for her orders to go. And that should be forthcoming. As we said, you'll hear this man, Pierre Bardier, give the orders. The orders come to him, the go or no go from the satellite comes from the satellite people to him, is that right? It's relayed?
Well, he is the overall manager of everything happening here tonight, so he has the synthesis of all the systems needed for the mission, and of course the spacecraft is a very important one.
Dave Cross, the man with the mustache in the center of your frame there, Astrea man, Skynet. He has no doubt been busy on the phone the last 15 minutes, but apparently they found the problem and fixed it. So we're waiting now again for the Sicral, as you can see, which is green, the Italian MOD bird, to go back to its green configuration. So all the panels will be green and go for launch. And at that time, we'll pick up with the synchronized sequence, and the clock will start ticking again down to liftoff for tonight's flight number 139. The Jupiter building here, you can see there are two parts. You're looking down into the fishbowl where the technical operational people are. The European space effort, a three-way affair between Ariane Space, the European Space Agency, and the French Space Agency, CNES. All these people are down in the fishbowl at their computers, along with, of course, the customers, the Sicral people, the Astrium people, the CTAB Consortium.
Yeah. CTAB Consortium.
The Jupiter building here went up in 1996, was used for the first time in 96. This is the second mission control that we had. We had another one which was used from flights 1 to 81, I believe. And this Jupiter 2 went up for the Ariane 5 program. First flight, flight 82, 1996. The old Jupiter building now, very different, used now for, I think, some tracking. They've split it up into two parts. I don't know what they're doing now.
Well, the old Jupiter 1 was very little, and especially for VIPs and guests. It was not so easy.
There wasn't much room, yeah. And we launched from the fourth floor of the building.
Yeah.
That's where the
near the roof,
were.
So it was very good for seeing the launcher flying.
This one is good too because the people, you might see them at
about.
All right, he says to get ready for a relaunch of the countdown very shortly. So, very shortly. You'll hear Pierre Bardier call out. The we started to mention there are some observation posts, there's some terraces outside of this building. And sometimes you see the people, the VIPs who are here in Jupiter, start to get up and move out with roughly 2 minutes to go before launch, minus 2 minutes, minus a minute and a half, start to go outside. Because they can watch the launcher pass, well, I've never seen it. I'm told it passes overhead, is that right? I'm always in here.
It is not really overhead, but since it flies in this direction, you have the impression it's coming towards you. In reality, there is a maneuver, which is called the dogleg, which is in charge of putting a right trajectory to avoid the launcher flying over Kourou, which could be a problem in the case of an accident, a major accident.
It's one of the reasons why the Europeans chose the space base here at Kourou. I think there were about a dozen candidates from Norway, from Scandinavia to Australia to build the site.
Yeah, West Indies.
Yeah, when they started looking.
À tous de l'EDO, retour au vert du satellite Sicral.
Well, there
attention
you have
pour le début de la séquence synchronisée de lancement.
There we have it. Pierre Bardier has announced the passage into the synchronized sequence. You can see the clock ticking again in the corner of your screen. We are green. And counting down the final moments of this final countdown. All's well that ends well after that long wait. Gives us a chance to tell you all about the synchronized sequence now, which is also called the automatic sequence. The computers basically are taking over. Power is passing from the ground control onto the launcher itself.
Yeah. Yeah, well, the two computer systems, which are in the launch center number two, where the Coel and his team are, one for the electrical systems, the other of the fluid ones. And here we have some images of the gantry withdrawal, the one main operation in the final chronology, taking the place at 5 hours and a half before the ignition, the liftoff, when all the manual operation on the launcher are over, and before starting the cooling and the loading of the third stage, of course.
This is done. This was done about 6 hours ago. These shots were shot in the afternoon. You can see what the weather was like this afternoon. Cloudy, but no problem. One of the last major operations, because, as we mentioned earlier, we're still filling up until minus 5 minutes the third stage with the liquid hydrogen and oxygen, and the launcher, which is normally inside the tower, should be outside.
Of course, the launcher
in the
must
open
be
area.
Outside while you fill up the third stage.
The CDL, the teams at the launch base, again going through their final checks and verifications on only launch procedures. This is a group of 100 or so people, or 200 people, only working on launch processes, correct?
Yeah, correct. And this is the place where the two famous computer systems are.
That you started to mention. Please carry on.
Of the electrical system, the other for the fluid and pneumatic, in charge tonight, especially of the third stage, topping up and checking off all the pressure parameter needed. And they have both a checking control, and we have the satellite image of the weather for tonight, so you can see no problem, no thunderstorm risk over Kourou and on the trajectory. So this is why the weather is green for all the window. We don't have a weather red.
We don't need another red. We already had one.
Yeah, and that's enough.
Yeah. So 1,001 checks going on this very complicated launch vehicle. All are vital signs being checked out by these two computers, fluids and electrical systems, which
checking
are located up in the CDL where we
checking
had the camera
on one side and making actions on the other. That is to say, both fluid and electrical. At this time, the loading of the third stage is over. They are making the pressurization of the tanks. And from the electrical side,
the image you're seeing now, we want to just take a minute and point that out to you. This is the, as you see, the cryotechnic arms, or the propellant feeder arms, which you mentioned earlier, the liquid hydrogen and oxygen, the 10 tons of that fuel going into the third stage, which the filling stopped at minus 5 minutes. This image is important because it's the last thing you're going to see before liftoff. These feeder arms, if all is go, at about minus 5 seconds, they will swing open. And if they don't swing open, we don't go anywhere. They must open for Ariane to lift off.
We see Mario Ciampini and Amedeo Galauchi.
The coming up on 2 minutes now, you can feel a little bit of the excitement and the tension in the air. I'm looking down into the on the VIPs, and they're watching as everybody here is, the green status panels, which continue to tell the story. At under 2 minutes, we are green and we are go. The synchronized sequence also authorizes.
And we have David Cross and Robert Hanville,
the Astrium Skynet people. Synchronized sequence also loading the exact ignition time into the computer, is that right?
Yeah, since it is the ground computer giving the relay to the onboard system. And for the guidance system, especially, we have the servo motor starting and the inertial platform unlocking just 9 seconds before the ignition time.
Right, just a moment at 1 minute now. You'll hear the DDO call out the 1 minute mark.
À tous les DDO, attention pour H moins 1 minute. Top moins 1 minute et décompte.
All right, we're into the final seconds of the final countdown. Flight 139 with two military satellites aboard. Just very briefly, what you'll see, the feeder arms will swing open, and you'll see the motors firing on the first stage, but the launcher will not go anywhere immediately. What happens?
It happens that in the ignition sequence, we check the engines starting to the full power for about 4 seconds, and everything is if everything is okay, we give the release order, four big hooks opens, release the launcher, and we have the real liftoff
then
in positive liftoff time.
At about plus 4
at
seconds.
At about plus 4.4 seconds.
All right, you're going to hear the DDO call out the final 10 seconds.
À tous de DDO, attention pour le décompte final.
And we'll let you watch that. And we'll be back after Ariane has cleared the tower.
9, 8, 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, unité, feu. Allumage. Décollage.
All right, you saw the launcher rise into the sky. We're 30 seconds into the launch now. You saw the four main engines burning and the four boosters were burning. We've lost Ariane in the cloud cover. You saw before the shots of the gantry withdrawal. It is a little
tous les paramètres bord sont normaux et la trajectoire est normale.
But the trajectory and everything aboard is normal, says the DDO. Did you notice something falling away from the launcher? Seemed to be some cladding. There's a nice shot of the launcher tracking through the clouds, coming in and out. Did you notice the there was what looked like some parts of the outside that were falling away? That's quite a normal occurrence, yeah?
The little things you saw falling at the liftoff, it is the thermal protection of the second stage, which is just foam plus aluminium, just to maintain it at right temperature while waiting on the pad. So it is normal to lose it.
Les paramètres bord sont normaux et la trajectoire est normale.
All right, everything is normal. You can see on the left hand of the screen the cursor, which represents the launcher, climbing up the normal trajectory path at one single point of light now. The four main engines are still burning, and the four boosters are burning. The boosters
les paramètres bord sont normaux et la trajectoire est normale.
The boosters will burn until roughly plus 2.5 minutes. These four main engines using a lot of fuel, about 2.2 tons per second. About a million pounds of thrust.
A million pounds of thrust and 250 kilograms each engine. So in eight engines, we have 2 tons per second.
2 minutes, and Ariane has already reached the speed of sound.
Yeah, we are already supersonic. In fact, at 1.5 meters, we have the transonic phase with the maximum dynamic pressure.
On the left-hand side, you see the cursor crawling up to the mark SEPPAL. That'll be the separation of the
extinction
boosters,
des propulseurs d'appoint à ergol liquide,
which have just been burned out, says the DDO.
Séparation des propulseurs d'appoint.
So we have just separated the boosters. They are going to fall back into the Atlantic. This will give you an idea of what happens.
Les paramètres bord sont normaux et la trajectoire est normale.
They are separated by a pyrotechnical device. They fall down in the Atlantic and they sink. But the separation sequence also opens them to avoid them to float, which can be dangerous for the ships. This is the way we want them to fall down and to sink in the ocean.
Coming up on the panel, you can see SEP1-2, that's separation of the first and second stage. That'll be forthcoming.
Tous les paramètres bord sont normaux et la trajectoire est normale.
Everything is fine on board. We mentioned earlier that the Kourou site was chosen. One of the main reasons was that we can launch to the north and to the east over the water. So there's no threat for local populations.
That was a very important criteria.
Extinction du premier étage.
So the propulsion of the first stage is over.
Séparation du premier étage.
And separated.
Allumage du deuxième étage correct.
All right, we're into the burning of the second stage. You can see in the drawing how that happened. Second stage burning one single engine. First stage again dropped into the Atlantic.
Tous les paramètres bord sont normaux et la trajectoire est normale.
Where it will sink in the drink. SEP coif, you see, that'll be the fairing separation. DDO will call that out.
Largage de la coiffe.
All right, now the separation is separated now. We're about 126 kilometers up, as you can see in the bottom right-hand corner of your screen where it says A, 129 kilometers, that's the altitude.
We can see the altitude and the velocity coming in this moment. They come directly from the telemetry from the launcher.
Les paramètres bord sont normaux et la trajectoire est normale.
Everything is right on board, all parameters correct.
The fairing is separated now at this height because we don't need it to protect the satellites anymore.
Yeah, we are outside, practically outside the atmosphere, so we get rid of all the masses which become
useless.
That's
right, it weighs, what is it, 750 kilos?
Tonight is about 650.
Tous les paramètres bord sont normaux et la trajectoire est normale.
It depends on the ferry. It is between 500 and 700 kilograms, so it's quite a very big mass on the payload. Pierre Mosva, director of the Guiana Space Center.
Fairing protecting the satellites from the Earth elements. Of course, we're in the above the atmosphere. We don't need it anymore. Payload pollution, that's what we call it. Avoids payload pollution. At 5 minutes and 40 seconds, roughly, the second stage burnout will be called by the DDU. You can see SEP23 on the chart. That's the separation.
Tous les paramètres bord sont normaux et la trajectoire est normale.
The second stage should take Ariane roughly to...
Extinction du deuxième étage.
Second stage burnout.
Séparation du deuxième étage.
Separation, second stage.
Allumage du troisième étage.
All right.
Les paramètres bord sont normaux.
The third stage burn has begun. This is the long one. Ariane speed now over 5 kilometers. That's per second. That's about half of the speed we need to separate the satellites.
Yeah, you're right. We are almost at the good altitude. Now it's about 200 kilometers. At the end, we'd be 239. So in this phase of flight, we really need the energy from the launch vehicle.
Les paramètres bord sont normaux et la trajectoire est normale.
To turn into speed.
Acquisition par la station télémesure de Natal au Brésil.
DDO has just announced the acquisition of our first downrange tracking station. That's over the border in Brazil at Natal. That's an ESA facility there.
Yeah, and in about 2 minutes, we will lose it from the crew station since the launch vehicle will be behind the horizon.
We're traveling at 5.5 kilometers per second. We're at 220 kilometers up, and we're in the beginning of the third stage burn. A long one, 14 minutes, burning the 10 tons of liquid hydrogen and oxygen that we mentioned, which is the space sector's most effective and efficient and most powerful fuel, is that right?
Oui, yes, cryogenic propulsion.
Les paramètres bord sont normaux, la trajectoire est normale.
It's very powerful. Well, indeed, you could use a fluor.
Satellite technology applied to telecommunications has made possible the use of advanced systems for multiple, diverse users. The fundamental aspect of today's communications to ensure the harmony and equilibrium of planet Earth is security. Today, military communications have a new ally, Sicral. Built by Alenia Spazio, the main contractor of the CTAP consortium, with Fiatavio and Telespazio. Undoubtedly, the use of innovative solutions makes the strategic system both valuable and competitive in terms of performance and able to meet the requirements of the Italian armed forces. Sicral performs numerous tasks, It is characterized by flexibility, low operating costs, and adaptability to changing operating conditions, especially appropriate in emergency conditions and peacekeeping missions. The system capability has required the design and development of transponders able to operate in three bands, EHF, UHF, and SHF. The Sicral system is composed of the space segment and the ground segment, which consists of the Mission Control Center, a Vigna di Varia, and over 100 user terminals. The system is characterized by mobility, safety, flexibility, and high performances. The spacecraft was designed and built in the Alenia Spazio facility in Rome. It will be put into orbit by an Ariane 4 launcher from the Guiana Space Center in Kourou.
Presso il centro di Vigna di Valle, il satellite viene gestito e controllato in orbita, mentre i vari sottosistemi elettronici e informatici sono costantemente monitorati e tenuti sotto sorveglianza. Nel centro,
all Sicral systems are monitored and controlled by the Mission Center in Vigna di Valle. Their links have been developed to integrate military satellite resources with traditional telecommunications.
I terminali rendono possibili I collegamenti via satellite.
The different terminals, which can be mobile, fixed or portable, can be linked together through the satellite. Mobile terminals can be installed on aircraft, ships or ground vehicles.
Vengono installati a bordo di aerei, navi e veicoli terrestri.
In addition to Alenia Spazio, the prime contractor in the CTEP consortium, 150 European and American companies have participated in Sicral.
Prossimamente coprono la quasi totalità delle ditte che operano in campo spaziale.
Con il satellite posizionato with the spacecraft positioned in geostationary orbit at 36,000 kilometers from Earth, Sicral will allow video, phone and fax links over a wide geographical area. The system, built according to international standards, guarantees telecommunication compatibility with the armed forces of other nations, in particular within NATO.
Right, well, you know the Sicral story. We'll get back with a little more on Sicral. But for now, since we have another 7 or so minutes in the third stage, Bruno, we have a little time. We want to go to the moment that you've all been waiting for, the Ariane Space quiz question.
And we have Mr. Minniti, which is Undersecretary of Defense, Italy.
So, Mr. Minister and everybody else, here's your quiz question for tonight. Ariane Space question, excuse me, number 139. Now, you know, we've launched...
Tous les paramètres bord sont normaux et la trajectoire est normale.
We've launched about 14 times with military payloads. 14 military launches since the Ariane space program began. Now, we have telecoms and hispasats. I count those because they're dual missions. They had military payloads. Telecoms, hispasats, Skynets, and Helios. Of all those 14 launches that we've done, how many, before tonight... Françoise Buzita, the young lady there, Ariane Space Secretary General,
Ariane Space.
The question again.
Les paramètres bord sont stables et la trajectoire est normale.
If I can get it in, the question is, before tonight's launch, how many of the military launches were double military payloads? I know you know the answer, it's an easy one. See how many out there read the website. Again, question number 139. How many...
Fan visibilité lanceur par la station de Natal au Brésil.
How many of the military launches before tonight were double launches, were military charters? Give you the answer
Il
in a minute.
Il reste 5 minutes de propulsion.
5 more minutes to go in the third stage burn. And while those minutes are burning away, take a look at the Skynet sat, and we'll be back with the answer.
Skynet 4F is the final spacecraft in the current line of military communication satellites built by Astrium for the UK Ministry of Defence and NATO. The last of the three Stage 2 spacecraft to be launched, it will join Skynet 4D and E, launched in 1998 and 1999, to extend the operational life of the current Skynet system and enhance its operational performance. All three satellites are to be delivered in orbit, on station, and fully operational. After in-orbit testing has been completed, Astrium hands the satellite over to the Ministry of Defense. In designing the Skynet Stage 2 spacecraft, advantage was taken of technological advances and proven mechanisms to increase the flexibility, performance, and reliability of the secure communication system. Introduction of antenna pointing mechanisms allows high-power spot and regional beams to be steered anywhere over the visible hemisphere, giving immediate support to unexpected out-of-area operations. Tunable UHF with an increase in transponder power and a new UHF antenna designed by AEA Technology enhances communications with mobile terminals. While greater power on the SHF transponders and revised channel bandwidths both increase the amount of traffic carried and improve performance with small tactical and man-portable terminals.
Right, 16 minutes into the launch, a little bit about the Sicral satellite. It's Mr. Start from Astrium. It's part of a system developed for the Italian MOD to establish communication links throughout Italy, also a wider area, including other parts of Europe, the Mideast, and West Africa. CEO of the Astrium Group, Mr. Carlier. Italy's first military satellite. The Italians also had were involved in the Helios bird, but this is the first dedicated Italian satellite developed by CTAB, the Alenia Spazio Telespazio Fiat Avio. Keith Smith, as you can see, the UK Defense Ministry. The contract was signed with Ariane in 97.
Il reste 2 minutes de propulsion, tous les paramètres bord sont normaux et la trajectoire est normale.
2 minutes left for the third stage burn. Ariane has launched all of Italy's Italsats and military devoted satellites. There is the Artemis, which is coming up, set to go in Ariane 5. That's later this year, also built by Alenia. Skynet. A few details about Skynet. The last of the group, the last of six. The bids for the 5 series are in. They went in last week, I believe. So we'll see what happens there. We were told by the Astrium people today that that contract will include ground stations. Pierre Bardier says there's a minute and a half left in the third
acquisition
stage.
De la télémesure lanceur par la station de Libreville au Gabon.
Now we've been picked up by our final tracking
il reste
station,
moins d'une minute de propulsion.
Which is in Libreville in Gabon, west coast of Africa. On the cursor screen there, XH10, extinction, that means H10 is another name, a code name for the third stage. Above that, Sicral, that's the point where that satellite will be separated, and higher up, the separation moment for Skynet. Skynet bigger, more powerful than the Stage 1 group.
Plus que 30 secondes de propulsion.
There is Jean-Jacques Dourdan, who's going to be taking over from Frederick Enstrom at ESA, in charge of the launch direction. Busy year for the ESA people because they got the ministerial meeting coming up in November, deciding on a lot of questions on the future of the Ariane program,
and
that's Mr. Dourdan's domain. Coming up on end of the third stage burn, which you'll hear from the DDO shortly.
Extinction du troisième étage.
There's the third stage burnout.
Début de la manœuvre d'orientation du composite au bénéfice de Sicral.
And we've gone into what we call as the ballistic phase.
Yeah, since we have no more propulsion, we are into orbit in this moment with the third stage and the two payloads. We are reorienting this upper composite, as we call it, to the right position in order to separate the first payload, in this case Sicral. The orientation ballistic phase is different from one payload to another.
La manœuvre d'orientation se poursuit normalement.
And this going on normally.
Yeah. You can have spin or not according to the satellite. In this case,
one is and one isn't tonight. Yeah.
There is one spin maneuver for Skynet and with no spin for Sicral, which will be separated.
Manœuvre d'orientation au bénéfice de Sicral.
Going on with orientation maneuver, which we Sicral will be separated.
Fin de la manœuvre d'orientation.
End of the orientation, we wait for the separation announcement in a few seconds.
That you'll hear from the DDO as well.
Séparation Sicral.
There we have it. Separation of the first payload tonight for the Italian MOD.
Début de la deuxième manœuvre d'orientation.
Happy moment for the Sicral people who look relieved. Sicral, well, there's a good shot. Two happy men. Before we get to the Skynet separation, I want to ask you about the what the composite is doing now. Just before we go to that, though, Pierre Michele, now that Sicral has separated the what they call in-flight operations, the first acquisition will be at plus 23 minutes. That's coming up very shortly at the Malindi station in Kenya.
La deuxième phase d'orientation se poursuit normalement.
The solar ray deployment at plus 2 hours and 40 minutes. First apogee burn in this bipropellant engine taking place at 36 hours and 51 minutes after liftoff. So what's happening now? We're running up to
de la deuxième manœuvre d'orientation.
What's going on up there?
We are still on the same orbit. We're reorienting the composite to the right position to separate Skynet. But before, we left the separation of the mini Spelda cover, which is the structure between the upper and the lower payload. And we will see on the graphic computer simulation
acquisition par la station de Malindi au Kenya.
Yeah, the Malindi station has just picked us up.
Séparation du capot Spelda.
There's the separation of Spelda, you mentioned. How long do we have to go before the separation of the of Skynet?
Separation Skynet in about 3 minutes from now.
Three more minutes. Oh, you want the answer to your quiz question?
Début while you're de la troisième manœuvre d'orientation au bénéfice de Skynet 4F.
So you see the top of the satellite since the Spelda cover has been separated.
3 minutes to go. Did you think about my question?
Yeah, I think about it.
How many military satellite launches until tonight?
La manœuvre d'orientation se poursuit normalement.
Have been double launches.
Well, what do you say? As long as I remember, I think it can be the first tonight, since Helios was a single, I remember. The other, I was too young, I don't remember.
You
but
keep saying that.
I think it's the first one.
Is that your final answer?
Yeah, it is.
Well, Pierre McKinnon, in all the years I've worked for you, this is the first time you've got the right answer. Congratulations.
Folks,
fine. For all you who guessed, this tonight is the very first double military launch that we've put up. The telecoms and the Skynets all went up with Astra's and Eutelsats and Hispasats. Skynet 4E went up with an Arabsat. Skynet 4B and 4C with Astra's and Eutelsats. These military launches go all the way back to flight number 10 on the first Ariane 3 launcher in August of 84. And interestingly enough, one name of a satellite builder is repeated throughout every one of those launchers, and the name is Astrium. Of course,
télécommande du satellite par lanceur.
In its previous avatars as Matra, then the British Aerospace, and MMS, Matra Marconi Space, builders for every one of the military satellites launched by Ariane. Hispasats, Telecom, Skynets, and Helios. So congratulations. Anybody who got the right answer, give us a call up here at 35862, and Pierre Michele will send you his check for $1.39.
And one bottle of champagne paid by Joshua.
Right.
1 minute before the expected separation time. And we will see normally on the simulation a spin maneuver, since in this case we have a spin maneuver for separation.
And the first satellite we did not. That is right. Because we have... now why is that?
It depends on the payload. In the Sicral case, it is separated in the right position to open the solar arrays as soon as possible on the right position with respect to the sun. So you don't need a spin separation.
You'll hear the DDO calling out the Skynet separation, and you will probably hear
début de mise en rotation du composite.
Spin maneuver. It is a slow spin, 30 degrees per second. Believe me, even if it is not on the screen.
Separation Skynet 4F.
And we have the separation Skynet. And a lot of happy people.
Yeah, the crowd very politely holding all applause until both satellites were separated. We're going to have exchange of ties here, looks like. Well, a lot of happy people here tonight. The champagne and the cigars will be, of course, forthcoming. We're going to go to the speeches from our principals as soon as they are ready. Probably Jean-Marie Luton, Ariane Space Chair, and Messieurs Carlier, Smith, Miniti, and Verilio for the satellite people. The in-flight operations for Skynet, first acquisition at a place called Reef in the Indian Ocean at about plus 27 minutes. That's not too far from now. Second ground station at Guam. Then the spin-ups. We'll come back to that, but for now, take a look at the first of what may be two or three launch replays. We'll be back.
And
tous les paramètres d'or sont normaux.
Those shots of the replay were taken from another camera at a site called Toucan, which is a lot nearer to the launch base, about 4 kilometers, roughly. We were saying the in-flight ops for Skynet. The first burn, the AKM burn, the Apogee motor burn, will come at the 7th orbit. Then despin and deployment of solar arrays at plus 83 hours. I think we're ready to go to Ariane Space Chair Jean-Marie Luton, who will be followed by the other principals and the satellite people. Monsieur Luton, over to you.
One more success for Ariane 4. You never get used to it. Tonight launch holds a special position in Ariane's history, since it is the first time the European launcher has carried two European military satellites on one single mission. This is a concrete proof that the Ariane system has met the political and strategical goal set back in 1973 of giving Europe an independent access to space. So our success is reached tonight to the satisfaction of two important European governmental customers. I would like to congratulate our friends from the British MOD and Astrium for their continuous confidence in Ariane, and the Italian MOD and CTAB for the launch of a first dedicated telecom satellite, Sicral. Italy is a pillar of the Ariane program, and Italy deserves this success. None of us needs to be reminded that Ariane Space owes a lot of the steady commitment of the European governments in ESA program. At this point, I would like to say a friendly word to our friends from of the other side of the pond in Europe. I know that this launch has been closely followed in Rome, Italy so. Buongiorno a tutti I nostri amici italiani. Auguriamo lunga vita al vostro satellite. I know that we also have a lot of British friends following us in Stevenage, UK as well. I can assure you that Ariane Space is very proud to have well served you today. Tonight's launch, which is the second success of the year, to be recorded for Ariane 4 in 2001, gives the launcher the credit of 61 successes in a row. A new world record for commercial launch. Tonight's success is also a celebration of European space industry. Almost all this community has contributed to the tonight achievement. Alenia Spazio, Fiat Avio, Telespazio, Astrium, and all the European companies involved in the Ariane programs, along with the CNES and CNES CLG and Ariane Space teams, all together, they made the true European achievement possible. We all know we will make many more successes possible in the future. Thank you very much.
Buonasera, io penso che dopo le emozioni di stasera ci resta ben poco da dire. Io voglio ringraziare i nostri amici di Ariane Space per aver fatto quello che dovevano. Adesso tocca a noi prendere il controllo del satellite e portarlo a fare quello che è stato previsto che faccia. E io cedo subito la parola al rappresentante del MOD, il ministro Minniti, che credo che voglia anche lui unirsi a me nelle ringraziare i nostri amici di Ariane Space.
Un grande grazie di cuore per il successo che abbiamo raggiunto questa sera. I momenti di tensione prima del lancio hanno reso questo successo ancora più significativo e bello. Una cooperazione importante in campo europeo che ha visto la partecipazione importante del mio paese, dell'Italia, attraverso tre grandi aziende italiane, Alenia Spazio, Fiat Avio e Telespazio. Un grazie di cuore per l'assistenza e per il lavoro comune che si è fatto e per l'importante risultato che questa sera abbiamo raggiunto. Grazie di cuore e io mi auguro che questa collaborazione così importante che oggi ha prodotto un risultato così significativo possa continuare nel nome di una collaborazione europea. Grazie.
Je suis prévu. Many thanks and congratulations to Ariane Espace for this superb launch. We are used to exciting success, one more. Congratulations to you. You will let me express as well congratulations to our team of people. They are in Portsmouth and Stevenage are listening to us, and I would like to extend a warm message of congratulations to you guys, very well done. And now let me hand over to Kay Smith, who represents the Minister of Defence of the UK, and we would like to say a few words. Right?
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. As I fear I'm speaking last, I shall be quick. I'm delighted and over the moon by what has been achieved this evening. I've just been told that we have telemetry from the satellite at Diego Garcia. That's obviously great news. My thanks to Ariane Espace again, a great success for European space. 2 years ago, I was privileged to be here for the launch of Skynet 4E. Obviously a success. 13 years ago, I must be getting old, I was involved actually in the launch of Skynet 4B, again on an Ariane 4 launcher. Ariane 4 continues to be a model of consistency, long may it live. Congratulations and good luck to the Sicral team, of course. The successful launch of Skynet 4F secures for the UK additional operational flexibility and capacity for UK armed forces wherever they are deployed, and will preserve the UK SATCOM capability well into the middle of this decade. My thanks to Astrium, to the teams that have worked so hard on the Skynet programme over nearly 20 years at Portsmouth and at Stevenage. What you have achieved, I believe, is a great testament to your skills and to your professionalism. And if I could just pick out three people who have been absolute giants in this programme and the Skynet programme, that is, and who have really seen it through at times, difficult times. My personal thanks go to Paul Down and David Cross of Astrium and Dennis Williams of my own team. Their contribution has been immense. We need people like that to see programs like this through. Thank you.
Il me reste maintenant
now
à vous donner.
All I have to do is just give you the date for the next launch. The next launch will be Ariane 5 at the beginning of March. During this time, we are going to change launch directors within the European Space Agency. I'd like to thank Frederik Engström, who has been a long-term supporter. He's been like a Viking. He has fought for our program and for the success of Europe in this area. So let's applaud him before he leaves. And I'd also like to greet his successor, Mr. Dordain, who will join us, the European launchers, from February, 15th of February. And so I think that's it for this evening. The next, the place we're going to meet now will be the Hotel Mercure.
Right, we are going to go to another launch replay for you. You can see from another angle. And then we'll be back to say our goodbyes.
Allumage. Décollage.
All right, those fine shots of the launch about a little over half an hour ago of Ariane Space Flight 139. That's 236 passengers now for us, the 182 satellites, 423 tons of mass all told. Another success for the European launchers. Did you want to say a goodbye to our friends in Rome and in the peninsula?
Yes, thank. Quindi grazie a tutti per aver passato questa serata con noi, è stato un bello spettacolo e arrivederci a presto, perché no, per il lancio di Artemis previsto quest'estate. Okay, Josh, thank you and back to you.
All right, well, until the next time, you heard Jean-Marie Luton say that's early March for the next Ariane launch. That's an Ariane 5. Continuing our success after tonight's 61st success in a row for Ariane. On behalf of everybody at the Space Center, thanks for being with us. I'm Joshua Jample. We'll see you next time. Good night, everybody.